Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for coming. Not an ideal time of the year, I realise, for this sort of event, but needs must, as they say. So for those of you who don't know, I'm Alan Tate. I'm the university's Vice Principal, Administration and Finance, and Chief Financial Officer, and I'll just kick off today's forum, set a bit of context, and then I will hand over to Maxine McKew, who is kindly going to MC the forum for all of those in the audience. I'm sure you know Maxine's a renowned journalist, author, politician, and now working on some projects at the university, amongst many other things. So I'll do that shortly. I thought for the context, I would just start by addressing the question that might be on people's minds about why the university has decided to go down the road of having a charter, and very broadly what that charter is trying to do, and then give you some feedback on the consultation process to date. So firstly, why a charter? So for those of you who've read Growing Esteem, which is the university's strategic statement, strategic plan, which the latest iteration was released earlier this year and goes for 5 years to 2020, that actually says that the university recognises that deepening its commitment to sustainability is critical to its responsibility as a public-spirited and global university. So critical from our strategic perspective. Growing Esteem actually goes a little bit further than that and says that we will lead in embedding sustainability in all of our activities. So that's teaching, obviously, teaching and learning, research, operations and engagement. So across all aspects of the university's work. And that, of course, is entirely consistent on teaching and learning and research goals. If you think of graduate attributes, where we are endeavouring, obviously, to prepare graduates to make as strong a contribution to societal issues as possible. And also on the research strategy side, where sustainability and resilience is recognised by the university as one of the grand challenges facing society and an area that the university is focusing a lot of its research. And then finally, there is and has been a lot of really good work on sustainability done by many of the people in this room, led by various areas of the university over recent years. I'm not sure that that's necessarily been well recognised. So what the Charter does and will do is bring those activities together in one clear framework, which can then be translated into priority actions, and we'll talk a little bit about the plan in a second. So that's sort of a segue into what is the Charter. And very simply, the Charter is designed to be an enduring document. It's not a short-term statement, nor is it a detailed statement. But it does set out or provide a set of values and principles that the university believes should be applied to sustainability, and then a range of commitments that the university will make to delivering on its commitment to lead and act in this area. So where are we at? As the screen behind me says, consultation on the charter began on October the 14th, and it goes till the end of December. And from that point on, before I go into that, just touch on some of the other things that have been done. As you know, there was a marquee, or some might have called it a tent, on South Lawn earlier this year to engage. There's been today's forum, there's been the website, there's been the dedicated mailbox, and tomorrow we've got the farmers market, where again there'll be another tent or marquee at which people can come along and provide their feedback, and there's been a range of committee consultations as well. On top of that, there's also been some external stakeholder interviews which are feeding into both the plan and the charter considerations. So we are genuinely interested in consulting on this. For those who might be sceptical about that, it is genuine. There are no preconceived outcomes, and there are no aspects ruled in or ruled out at this stage. If I go to the feedback itself, all of this is on the website. You can read all of the submissions received, of which there have been over 100. I think it's fair to say that those submissions have been very well thought out. They demonstrate the passion and commitment and engagement of the university community on this area. The demographics, as you can see there, there's a bias towards students in terms of the number of people responding, but still significant number of staff in that process. And then the unidentified others who, you know, obviously sit in one of those camps or in just the more general community. And the key themes, not surprisingly, I'm sure you'd agree, divestment is one of the things that people are keen to tell the university about and feed into the charter process and thinking. There's been feedback on strategic, the strategic side of the charter along the lines of how the university should lead, how it should position itself, some comments about you know, the impact of digital and data and how we can use that. There's then been more explicit statements, particularly around environmental issues and social issues, picking on those two parts of the thinking. And then finally, there's been some specific wording suggestions and also some pointers towards how the consultation process should work, particularly early on. There was concerns about how that would work, and hopefully we've addressed those as we've gone along. There's also been a range of university internal committees, such as council, a range of council committees, university executive, academic board, and then institutes and advisory boards across the university all have had a say in the feedback. So where to next? As I said, consultation finishes on the 31st of December for the charter. That feedback will then be taken into account and a final document prepared. And then the view is that that would be released on or around the start of first semester. Of course, as I said earlier, an important part of this will be then translating that into actions. So actions, milestones, timeframes, metrics, and indeed targets. So that will be the role of the sustainability plan, which will also go to 2020, and it will be worked on and consulted on in the first half of next year, with a view to releasing that in and around July. And finally, the university has committed to sustainability reporting, and that will take place on or around the end of March as well. And that will, of course, then be ongoing to monitor our progress on the charter and the plan. All of this information is available on the website, and cool, we've got a hashtag as well, so feel free to delve into that at any time. And finally, it's always great to celebrate successes. And the most recent one, and there's many of those, as I said, and I think others like Roger may touch on some of these as well, but the university was incredibly successful at the Green Gown Awards recently, won, I think it says, a hat-trick of awards, particularly the most prestigious one being the Continuous Improvement Award. So congratulations to all those in the university who have worked hard on that, Claire, Danielle, and everybody else. And long may it continue. So with that as an introduction, I will hand over to Maxine, who will manage the panel and the rest of the speakers.
Thanks, Alan.
Do you need the...
I've got this one. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks, Alan. And good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to join you here today. And an important point of protocol, could I start by acknowledging that we meet on traditional lands and acknowledge the Wurundjeri people, the people of the Kulin Nation, and pay our respects to their elders past and present. And we acknowledge any traditional elders who may be here with us today. Well, look, this is an important topic, and I'm very pleased to be asked to chair this event today. Of course, it acknowledges the important role that the university has in leading on this issue, a question of social responsibility to, of course, lead public debate and action towards a sustainable future. And I've just looked at the university's commitments in this area. When we're talking about the Sustainability Charter, it's based on these six important principles: leadership through example, interdisciplinary research, active global citizenship, equity in the use of resources, transparency and accountability, and urgent action if necessary. Well, of course, we're meeting in the wake of Paris as well, and boy, hasn't that put a spring in the step of many people who've been working on this issue for a very long time. Some of them are with us today, like Professor Ross Garnaut and Roger D'Argaville. Our format today is to hear from our speakers, and we've got two windows of Q&A. So I know there are people here with very well thought out positions on sustainability, the other related question of divestment, which is part of this, but of course it's a much wider topic. So we're keen to, we've got a good amount of time to have a good interactive session. So first of all, let me just introduce our panel to you. Sitting next to Alan, of course, is Professor Ross Garnaut, a professorial fellow here at the Faculty of Business and Economics. Next to Ross is Ellen Sandell, the State MP for Melbourne, the Greens member, and of course Ellen is also a spokesperson in her party for climate and energy. Next to Ellen is Dr. Roger D'Argaville, Deputy Director of the Energy Research Institute here at the university, and Anissa Rogers, who's just been appointed as the university's student representative, the elected environmental representative, starting as of this December 1. So great timing. We'll hear from our speakers in turn. But look, first of all, Alan mentioned the conversation on the South Lawn a little while ago. So we've got some vox pops. We'll just have a little look at the video of some of those comments to kick us off.
So I think it was the birth of my first child that made me think about the future that he was going to face and his children.
The Sustainability Charter is really a document to show the university's values and principles, commitment to sustainability.
It's a statement of aspiration around improvement in that, but it's also a statement of commitment.
It's really exciting to see that the university is engaging with students on the Sustainability Charter.
Personally, I see that as a signal of the university recognising its responsibility to lead strongly and to act decisively in regard to issues of sustainability and climate change.
I think the Sustainability Charter is a really important step for the university to really try and lift its game and meet the expectations of society that we really are experiencing greater pressures and there is a greater need for the university to become a real leader.
I think it's important to understand that the university through this moment is really seeking fairly broad input into the discussion around the charter.
Right, well, after that little scene setter, let me now introduce Ross Garnaut for us. And Ross is going to give us, for about 6 or 7 minutes, a post-Paris picture. So, Ross, thank you.
Thanks, Maxine. Well, I think the second last of the comments on the video sets the scene properly. What the charter does is take a step in moving sustainability issues into the mainstream of what the university does. We won't have completed the journey until sustainability ceases to be a separate issue. It's just part of the way we study everything and teach everything, and it needs to be. It's not the way members of our species have gone about their lives for the past 60,000 years since we left Africa. We've tended to think and work as if we lived in a world of infinite capacity to absorb what humans hand out to it. And it's only relatively recently, the last half century, especially the last couple of decades, that there's been realization that, that there are many fundamental constraints on continuation of life the way that we've been living it. And so I think we have to get used to thinking of good economics just incorporating a sustainability perspective, a good history bringing in the history of humanity's failure to come to grips with this issue and then gradual realization that it was important. We will have reached our destination on sustainability when it's not a separate subject, it's just part of how we teach and do research on everything. I think the draft charter is a pretty good statement of general principles. The big challenge will be how to make it operational, to make it part of a really good step, a helpful step in the direction that we need to move. I think if we take the principle seriously, it can be that step. Maxine suggested that I should say something about climate change after Paris. Climate change is simply the most acute, urgent and large of the sustainability issues. It's one of many, but it's one of such dimension that if we fail to get it right as a species, as a global society, then it will upset the beneficent process of growth in our civilization that's been underway at least since the last ice age. It deserves some priority simply because of the scale and the priority of the issues. It's also a particularly complex issue. It's a sustainability challenge that can't be solved by a single country. It involves very difficult questions of intergenerational equity as well as international equity. It involves one of the challenging areas of standard economics, the management of external costs when the activities of some people impose costs on others, but the externalities are global, not local or national, so it's particularly difficult to take them into account. And so it's urgent, it's large in its consequences, and it's complex, so it's come into centre stage. And I think we can say that Paris marks a point at which we can say that the world has started to come to grips with the issue. We had false starts along the way, and not surprising given the complexity of the challenge, the political and intellectual complexity. It's only really the late 80s that the science was clear on the quantitative importance of the issue. That's the issue of global warming has been there in physics since the late 19th century, but it's only the last few decades that we've had credible studies quantifying the potentially disruptive effect of climate change. I suppose if you want to date the time when serious people could have been expected to take notice of the quantitative dimensions of the challenge, it was around the time of Hansen's evidence to the US Senate in the late 80s. the world started to respond to that fairly soon with the Sustainability Summit in Rio de Janeiro in 1992, amongst other things. Over that period, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change was set up, which is the largest and most successful example of large-scale international cooperation in science that we've ever seen. That's quite an achievement in itself, for all the criticisms that are made of it. And then from the mid-90s, there were serious attempts to come to grips with the issue nationally and globally, with the intergovernmental processes of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. A framework was established at Kyoto in 97. It turned out to be a false start, most importantly because it failed to recognise that developing countries as well as developed countries would have to make major contributions from an early stage. That premise was blown apart by the unique episode of Chinese economic growth through the first decade of this century, which completely blew apart expectations of emissions growth from developing countries. Our first tentative attempt to come to grips with those broader issues failed at Copenhagen in 97. That was an attempt to extend the Kyoto framework into a world in which developing countries also accepted obligations. That attempt failed because it was based on a flawed view of what was possible and what was desirable. And in the years since then, we've been cleaning up that view. The basis of the success in Paris is a completely different approach to international cooperation, an approach based on concerted unilateral mitigation, with big responsibilities being devolved on individual countries to make their own commitments. That process will only work if peer pressure across countries and domestic political pressures on government is effective in upgrading national commitments over time. So far, so good in the last 4 or 5 years. Australia is a laggard in that process. We haven't got as far within this process as other developed countries, as Europe, as Japan, as the United States, now with the new government, as Canada, as Korea. There are signs that we will lift our game. Within this process, a great intellectual institution like this one has a big role in thinking through the issues and leading by example, as the Charter envisages. There's a big structural change that the world has to go through, but we now know that that's a manageable change. It need not upset life as we know it, or even economic life as we know it, if we do it right. A lot of the work of the Melbourne Energy Institute demonstrates that we can make energy transitions that are consistent with our playing our full part in a global movement towards zero net emissions by the middle of the century, and do that at reasonable cost. The Charter envisages that we will lead by example in what we do, and there's no good reason why the university itself can't move quickly to zero net emissions. And I think that that's a good practical way of leading by example. There's been, in the video, we saw evidence of a lot of interest in the divestment question. The big question is whether people who are making investments in our name, endowment investments or superannuation investments, are actually getting good value for their money. The average value of coal shares on the New York stock markets has fallen by 80% since the Chinese model of economic growth changed in 2011. The charter talks about transparency and accountability. I think the accountability question is, were investments made in coal-based stocks in 2011 when analysts like myself were pointing out that the change in the Chinese model of economic growth towards greater sustainability would undermine the business models of the world's main coal-producing companies. And so I think that those questions of accountability and transparency are very important. But there's a sense in which the horse has bolted. If there was some of our endowment or superannuation money invested in coal stocks in 2011, we've already lost most of the value. There's a bit left, and it's worth undergoing analysis to make sure whether we would save any of that by getting out. But the main question is an historical one. Were there errors, and why were errors made? Bye.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks very much, Ross. And I'd ask Ellen Sandell now to give us a government and a community perspective on sustainability. Thanks, Ellen.
Thanks so much, Maxine, and thanks, Ross, for that presentation. I'm really pleased to be here as the local member representing this institution in this suburb. Also, thank you to the university for doing this consultation, particularly having people like myself and others on the panel who might even challenge some of the university's existing ways of operating. I think that's a really great way that you've consulted us. I'm going to talk a little bit about my background at the university and then a little bit about the university's need to take action in the context of failure of action at national and state levels. That's what I've been asked to talk about. So I'll tell you a bit about my background to set a context for my involvement in the university and my interest in what the university does here, particularly on sustainability. When I was 17 years old, I moved from Mildura in the northwest of the state to Melbourne to come to the University of Melbourne to study science and arts, a double degree. And I learnt from some amazing academics here, people like David Caroli, about the impacts of climate change. But I have to say a lot of my learning was outside the classroom, in I guess what you could call the classroom of university life, being the environment officer, the NGOs that I was involved in here, the activism I was involved in on campus really shaped my understanding of some of these sustainability issues. And once I learned about climate change and the fact that we still log our native forests here, like any thinking student, I decided that I wanted to do something about it. I wanted to get involved. And the first campaign I ran was actually here at the university, my very first campaign, because it's where I was, it's all I knew really at the time. So I thought, wouldn't it be great if the university bought all of its paper, copy paper, from recycled sources rather than from our native forests? And I sincerely hope things have changed in that time, and I believe that they have, because the university was very slow to act and put up a lot of barriers to students acting in those days, more than 10 years ago. And I remember I found out who the person who dealt with procurement of paper was, and I went into their office to talk to them and said, here's all the water and energy and forest you would save by switching to recycled paper. And he said, oh, but Ellen, you realise we can't switch to recycled paper because it's slightly less white than the other paper that we use, and it will look odd if we staple two pieces of paper together that are different colours. And I sincerely hope attitudes have changed at the university since then. And we gave up on that campaign because it seemed too difficult, but I went on as Environment Officer to run a 3-year-long campaign to get the university to switch to 100% green power. And the university put up several barriers along the way. The first barrier they told us once we wrote to the Vice-Chancellor about this idea was that there isn't enough renewable energy in the Australian grid to power the university. Luckily, we nipped that one in the bud and showed them that it's okay, don't flatter yourselves, you're a great big institution, but there's enough renewable energy in the whole country to power you. And the second barrier they put up was that it would cost too much, which is a valid concern for any institution. But instead of giving up, we got an energy analyst to come in and do an energy efficiency survey of the university, and the university funded that to their credit, to look at where the university could actually save energy. And the expert came back and said we could save about a third of our energy through some simple measures, including plugging in the solar panels on the physics building that no one had plugged in. And so we said, how about you invest that money that you've saved into green power? And they said, look, actually what's at the heart of this is that it's not a priority for the university, and students and staff don't care enough and aren't making enough noise. And as the environment officer, that's music to my ears, because I knew that the students did care, and I could run a campaign to convince the university that that was the case. So after 3 years and getting 10% of the student population to sign a petition, getting alumni to sign a petition, cheekily getting Year 12 students to sign petitions saying they wouldn't come here unless the university bought green power, getting the staff and academics on board, we put our case to the University Council, and they agreed back in 2007 to go carbon neutral by 2030 and 50% carbon neutral by 2010. And I don't actually know where progress on that is up to, and that's probably my failing from leaving the university and not keeping up to date with progress. But I do remember a few years ago going to the toilet in the old arts building and seeing some nice posters on the back of the toilet doors talking about savings in energy that the university has made. So hopefully the university is on the path to that carbon neutrality goal, or has achieved it already, which would be wonderful. Zero net emissions, I think Ross said, would be a wonderful goal. But I tell these stories not to criticise the university, but to look back on how far we've come in those 10, 12 years since I was at university. What seemed impossible 12 years ago is more than possible today, with changes in technology and changes in public attitudes. But there is so much more to be done, and I hope attitudes at the university have changed so that we can actually do things differently and we can do things better. Because facing these huge challenges, as Ross outlined some of them, it requires incredible ambition. It's not something that just requires a few tinkering around the edges. And it means that it could be incompatible with a lot of the way we do business as usual, but also it could create incredible opportunities for institutions like universities. And unfortunately, we cannot sit back and wait for someone else to act. We cannot say we are just one institution and it's up to state government or national government or global agreements. Because the unfortunate facts of the matter are that those kinds of agreements at national or state levels are not getting us to where we need to go. So if we look at the Paris Agreement, wonderful that governments have said we have this broad aim to keep global warming under 1.5 degrees. But if you look at all the pledges and promises countries have put on the table, that could add up to more than 3 degrees of warming unless something significant changes. If we look at what the Australian government took to Paris, as Ross mentioned, we are real laggards in this process. Malcolm Turnbull took Tony Abbott's targets to Paris. They weren't changed in any way. And an NGO in Germany put together a list of all the countries that are responsible for 90% of the world's emissions, and Australia was the third worst on that list. The only countries that are worse than us are Saudi Arabia and Kazakhstan. So that's the kind of company that we're keeping at a national level. And if we look at state government action, the new state government here in Victoria has made some excellent noises in regard to renewable energy and energy efficiency. But the fact is they still have no plan to phase out our dirtiest coal power plants, which are the dirtiest in the country. And they are squeezing renewables out of the market. So we can talk about renewables all we like, but unless we remove some of that old coal from the system, renewables are not going to flourish here in Victoria. And unfortunately, we currently don't have a plan at a state level or a national level to do that. And so really the message is that institutions, individuals, groups are the ones who have to do the heavy lifting, unfortunately. We are the ones who are going to make these agreements work. Paris in and of itself isn't going to solve anything. It is creating the momentum so that all of us can get up out of our seats and push governments further and take action in our own institutions. And the good thing about Paris that I took heart from was that it sent a very strong message to the global community that the era of fossil fuels is over. And as Ross said, it already was over in 2011. It was on the sliding downwards. And now we have this very strong signal from the international community that fossil fuels are over, and any institution that continues to hitch its wagon to those kind of industries, whether it's through research or teaching or investment or whatever it may be, is really kidding themselves that that is going to create the jobs and the prosperity of the future. It's not. And universities can get out now. Maybe the horse has bolted on some occasions, but we can get out now and create opportunities in the new economy instead. So I want to end by just talking about Paris. Bill McKibben, who is the founder of 350.org and a writer from the US, described it in a way that I really liked, which is that it's like all the world's countries came together and decided that they were going to run a marathon in under 3 hours. But then they went home, and just agreeing that you're going to run a marathon doesn't actually make it so. You still have to get up off the couch every day, go for a run, stop going out drinking all night, put down that pack of chips. You actually have to do the work to get you there, even though you've made the promise to yourself and your friends. And Paris is a bit like that. We now need to go out there and do the work to make countries do their work to get to that 1.5 degree target. And I see the Charter as a little bit like that as well. There are some wonderful statements in here. It's wonderful that we're setting the values of this university in regard to sustainability, but actually it'll be what happens next is the meat of it, and what all of us do to push the university as staff members, as students, as academics or whatnot. That'll be really where the test is. How does the university actually aim to meet those goals? And will the ambition be enough to meet the challenges that are ahead of us? Thank you.
Thanks, Ellen. Well, good to hear that your activism and, you know, your started right here on this campus. It took you all the way to the State Parliament. Good for you. Look, Alan, you've got to answer the first question. Recycled paper, what's the university doing? And after 2007 and Ellen's pitch at the University Council, what's happened? How carbon neutral is the university?
Well, thank you, Maxine. recycled paper is the norm. In fact, I think less paper is the norm rather than simply recycled. So I think Ellen should be happy about that. On the carbon neutrality, so the target is still carbon neutrality by 2030, and we're certainly meeting our milestones along that track, but we are reviewing that target as part of the planning process, as part of this overall process. So it may be that we decide that that's not ambitious enough and that changes. So that's part of the next stage.
Okay.
Great, I'm glad I came.
There you go, okay. Look, I just want to, I've got questions coming. I just want to know, because his time is tight, we are in Paul Kaufman's faculty here and I can see him up there. I just want to throw a question to you, Paul, on the back of what you've heard here. Again, how do you see the leadership that the university is required to take on this? And perhaps to bring it back particularly to this area, in terms of training this next generation of students, economists, and those will go into the finance, into the business world, around, I suppose, embedding the principles of sustainability, broadly defined, in what they learn and what they take from here.
Thank you. Bit of a Dorothy Dixer, I think, but I'm happy to. It was a good opportunity for myself, I think, to take stock of what we do in this space, in the faculty, whether we're listening to the students, because that really is what has transpired, I think, in our curriculum, in our research, is what the students are expressing. So yes, our mission and our vision is to make sure that we educate future leaders. Leaders in their professions, leaders in society. And that means in their profession that they're going to manage businesses in an ethical way, in a responsible way, in a way that is going to be sustainable. So to make that happen, that's a big call. It's those graduate attributes that we want our students to have. But to make that happen, we've got a whole raft of teaching programs for them. And I wish, like Ross just mentioned, I think that one day it's no longer necessary to teach an ethics subject as a standalone, but to have that ingrained basically in all our curriculums. But that's not where we're at present. And the same applies, I think, to sustainability. We're not there yet. And by being not there yet, I think it pays off to actually highlight those initiatives in a specific way by offering identifiable subjects. We do that, for example, through the Office of Environmental Programs. We got a Master of Environment, graduate certificates, and what have you not. All heavily borrowing on interdisciplinarity. Our students, as I mentioned, are proactive in this space. They set up a microfinance initiative, for example. So it's not just the environment. There is also the socioeconomic sustainability that we want to focus on here. Things like street finance, financial literacy programs that we bring out to outer Melbourne schools, underrepresented schools, disadvantaged schools. As I mentioned, we got business ethics, finance ethics, sustainability accounting. And that spills over nicely, I think, in a bit of a hallmark research program, where the carbon footprint of the Botanic Gardens is now routinely computed by a team of accountants and land and food resources academics. But there are also things like poverty, addressing poverty through the Journeys Home and homelessness initiative here within the Melbourne Institute, and food security programs. So we do a lot. I can list off the whole list, but that's besides the point, I think. We do increasingly pay attention. And as I said, the important thing is that the students are, by and large, driving a lot of this. We would never have dealt in our finance classes with microfinance were it not for that initiative by a group of very dedicated students. Mm.
Good. Paul, thank you very much for that. Good. And I saw a hand over here. Who's doing our mics, by the way? How are we getting? Oh, you got one. Good. Okay. Terrific.
I think you can hear me now. I teach in the Office for Environmental Programs, so I'm an academic here with a strong interest in sustainability. Maxine, it's wonderful to have you here. I think of you as a bit of a dinosaur slayer in your own political life. It was great to see the back of somebody who resisted sustainability changes in Australia. I'm very happy that we're having the conversation. I'm very sad we're having it on the 16th of December. I think it'd be really easy to fill a much larger auditorium with concerned students and staff. So that's a disappointment for me, but nevertheless, it's great that we're having the conversation.
But as you know, this has been one of many.
This is the first forum. We've had a barbecue.
Previous conversations. Okay, all right, fair enough.
The main point that I would like to make, and for those of you who haven't picked one up, I and my colleague Hans have written an alternative sustainability charter. Given that we feel that at the moment the current draft is a little bit weak and could be strengthened. So the first thing I think that's really important is that we define what we mean by sustainability. The charter doesn't seem to do that. So I think that if we don't clarify that right up front, then we're working in the dark. The second thing that I think is really important is, as you know, with all due honour to the fossil free campaign and to all due honour to Paris and all of that concern, from a sustainability perspective, if we are not conscious that it is not simply a question of addressing our energy mix, but it's got a lot to do with our general attitude and our everyday practices and our governmental practices that need to change. So I think the picture is bigger than fossil, as important as fossils are. Cool. So I might just leave it at that.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for that. Ellen, do you want to make a response? Because I know that...
That I completely agree. Sustainability is so much bigger, and I know Ross mentioned that climate is only one part of it, even though climate is such a huge issue. And it does involve governance, it involves transparency, it involves the way that we look at our buildings, not just in terms of sustainability, but livability, and will they actually be livable buildings into the future, or will they just be buildings that nobody wants to live in 20 years if they're built really shoddily? It just involves so many different aspects, social justice, poverty alleviation. There's so much in it. So absolutely, it's a huge challenge for the university. I hope they're up for it.
Okay. And Ellen, I'm right in saying the alternative charter that's been drafted is going to be an important part of the ongoing consultations and redrafting.
That'll be taken into account with all the other feedback. Yep.
Right. Good. Okay. Who's next? Yes.
Faculty of Business and Economics. I wanted to ask about the process of the charter and of the following sustainability plan and what role the university's Executive Council, I think it's called, will play in it with the divestment movement, the academic board passed that unanimously and then the university knocked it back, I believe, twice. So what is the process of the charter and the plan?
Probably for me to answer.
Alan, yep.
So, Ben, I'm not sure to what you're referring when you say the university has knocked back whatever it's knocked back, but the process certainly will be, as part of the plan, there will be a consultation process and there will be public forums to discuss all elements of the plan and... our investment policy is one of those issues. The final approval is the council of the university, but it will also go through the university executive on the way to the council, but that will have had significant consultation along the way. But I'm happy to follow up on what's been knocked back.
All right, did you want to follow up on that? Just a quick one?
So what I understand with the divestment movement was that the fossil-free student society proposed it to the academic board and it was passed unanimously. And then the council, said that they wouldn't support it, and the vice-chancellor wrote an open public letter, which I think was possibly published in The Australian, explaining the university's position on it. So it is possible that this same process might get enormous support across the university and yet come up against those same sort of hurdles at the end.
I know what you're referring to now, and that was part of the process in getting to here, and the council referred part of that issue to other council committees for follow-up and to look across the board at all the elements associated with sustainability. So that's been part of the journey as to why we're sitting here today and where we're going in terms of the plan. It's, I guess, entirely possible that not all views will be represented in the plan and the charter, inevitably, because the university is a very broad church and there's a whole range of views on a whole range of issues. But as far as possible, the consultation will be taken into account.
Good. OK. Is there one more? I'll take this question and then I'll introduce Roger. Thank you. Yep, we're getting a microphone to you. There we go.
Is it?
That's it. It's on.
Cool. My name's Arpad. I'm from the city of Melbourne, and I see Claire sitting down the front there. Can I mention what we've been working on? Yeah. So... City of Melbourne, along with another approximately 14 organisations, have been getting together a pool of electricity of about 120 gigawatts to take to market early next year to run a tender. So we're limited by what we can say at the moment because we're under very strict probity rules. But just from my perspective as an outside organisation working with the sustainability people here at the University of Melbourne, it's been fantastic because your participation has really added momentum and has helped us to get a lot of the other stakeholders on board and in the tent, and it's going to be quite an exciting groundbreaking, if I may say so ourselves, project.
Well, that's good
so
to
thank
hear.
You. Yep. It's more of a comment than a question, really.
That's good to hear. Very good. Thank you. Okay. Look, I'll just hold the questions for the moment and we'll hear from our next two speakers and then we'll have some more questions. So, Roger Dargaville, if you could take the stage for us. Thanks. From the Energy Research Institute. Thanks, Roger.
Thanks very much, Maxine, and thanks for having me for this very interesting forum, an important forum. Brief was to talk firstly about the urgency for action, and there's two aspects to it, but the first one I'm going to talk about is from a global point of view, is what's actually happening with the climate as of just very recently. And my background is as a climate change researcher, and so if you put me in a room with a PowerPoint projector and a captive audience, I can't help but show you a slide with data. So what you've got here are the blue dots are the monthly climate, global surface temperature anomalies from the start of the 20th century up until October this year. And the red dots are the annual averages. And I think you'd be pretty hard-pressed to deny that there is a significant and dramatic increase in the temperatures. If we just zoom in on the last 25 years here, one thing which might stick out to you very quickly is in 1998, we had a very large temperature anomaly. And what happened since then was it took quite a while before that record was broken again. And a lot of climate deniers especially were saying, since 1998, the temperature hasn't warmed, that the globe hasn't warmed. But what's happened in the last few years, and most dramatically, just in October this year, this is the monthly anomaly for October in the red line there, is that this record has been smashed. What happened in October is really quite frightening. And so I make the case that the case for urgent action is as strong as ever. That were the global temperature anomalies. So what's happening in Australia? This is the map of the temperature anomalies for October for this year. And this brown... Anomalies? Oh, so the difference from the long-term mean. So does that help? Yeah. So, I mean, how different the temperatures are from what you'd expect for the climate average. And this big brown blob here, a lovely colour chosen by the Bureau to describe... temperature anomalies that are 6 degrees or more. So 6 degrees, that sounds like a lot. It is a lot. These are really extraordinary conditions. We're very fortunate in a way that it happened in October and not in January or February, because it probably didn't feel so incredibly uncomfortable. But from an environmental point of view, this is really quite scary, because all kinds of biological cycles, especially that we depend on for agriculture and so forth, are very sensitive to these kind of temperature changes, even in October. And so if we look at what that means for climate records in Australia, the orange here again is where the temperatures are highest on record. And you can see half of the country was experiencing its highest anomalies, so most outside of the expected range that we've ever seen in October this year. So this is extremely disconcerting and drives home the point that we need action as fast as possible. On the second point of the need for action, I'd like to reiterate some of the points that have already been made by the panel, that as the University of Melbourne, as one of the leading institutions in Australia and, in fact, the world, we have a ethical and moral duty to be doing more than average. We have to be a shining beacon and a leading example to the rest of the world, or especially the rest of the country. So at the university, we have the option of just being a normal company. We could have, say we were a stockbroking firm or a manufacturing company, we could do the right thing and just go and buy carbon credits. That would be a good thing to do, to have 100% green energy. But given the brains trust that we have in this institution, I think we should take the higher road and do more than that. And what we should be doing is using the university as a test bed, as a sandbox, to be doing really interesting and novel things that are ahead of the curve. So not just going with what the status quo is. So I'm the Deputy Director of the Melbourne Energy Institute, and what we have on campus here is an incredible wealth of research experience and knowledge across a very broad range of fields. I'm just going to go through the list of projects that we have currently going on campus in the renewable energy space. So we have printable solar PV panels being done at Bio21. We do a lot of research into energy storage, so liquid air energy storage, pumped hydro, hydrogen and ammonia are interesting possible technologies. We do carbon capture and storage technology, which may be controversial. So that's where you still have your fossil fuel power station, but you capture the carbon and pump it underground. Our philosophy is to be technology neutral. We'll look at any technology if it has the potential to be part of the solution. And so that's in there as well. Geothermal is a big area of research. We look at both deep hot rock geothermal and direct geothermal, which I'll talk about a bit more in just a moment. We'll look at novel ways for making biofuels from algae, the effect of electric vehicles in the grid. We do quite a lot of economic modelling of the future energy system and also of energy systems in general. So we have a suite of models for modelling Australia's energy system. There's also building materials, and I could probably go on for a bit longer. So what you see is there's an extraordinary wealth of energy experience and expertise on campus that we're hoping to tap into. Now, coming back to geothermal again, one of the highlights for me, at least on campus, is that two of the buildings, the Walter Boas and the Bow Repair Centre, are both heated and cooled by shallow geothermal energy. And you probably not too many people know about that because it's invisible. You can't see anything. There are pipes have been drilled into the ground that take advantage of the relatively stable ambient temperature several metres below the ground, and that temperature is used to heat and cool those buildings in winter and summer. The other big success story, which Emmy I can't claim any credit for, but Harriet Trudell and Claire and Danielle and other people, is the 100 kilowatt system on the roof of Wilson Hall. So does everyone know that we have 100 kilowatts of PV on the roof of Wilson Hall? I think that's extraordinary, but again, it's invisible, so you can't see it unless you get up above it. So the university is actually doing really interesting things in the energy space, but I think we can do an awful lot more. And rather than just buying green credits, which would be a noble thing to do and a good thing to do, we should actually be investing money in doing things that are ahead of the curve, and that might be through novel processes such as load shifting, moving our demand from peak times to off-peak times, investing in novel forms of storage, and possibly also directly negotiating with a wind farm to buy that wind farm's energy to supply the financial security for that wind farm to actually go ahead. So circumvent the whole system, buy our renewable energy directly from the producers. That's my list of things I was hoping to talk about. I'm very happy to answer any questions about, especially the technical side of renewable energy and what can be done on campus. Thank you very much.
Just before you, Roger, just on those things you mentioned, what do you think is feasible for the university in this next phase? What would you see? What would you like to see University of Melbourne, if you like, accelerate in the next couple of years?
Well, I think the no-brainers are to install a lot more PV. PV is now at relatively low cost. We have a lot of roof space available, and so we should do it. And as Alan will know, the issue with putting up things like PV is it's a relatively expensive way to generate electricity, because the university actually doesn't pay very much for its electricity. We're a very, very large consumer, and so we negotiate an extremely good rate with our supplier. And so when we put up things like PV, which if you're a homeowner and you're paying 25 cents a kilowatt hour, it makes very good economic sense. But the university is paying quite a lot less than that, and so we take a financial hit when we go to something like PV. But it's a hit that we should be taking in the interest of being more sustainable. But it has to go against a little bit of economic logic, and you have to make a case for it. And so that's something which Alan has to do, which is very okay. Hard work, I'm sure.
Okay. I'll get a comment from you later.
I guess the other side would be in building efficiency. So the best way to use renewable energy is to not use it in the first place. And so to decrease energy use through better building design, but also better energy practices, simple things like just getting everyone to turn the lights off and turn the air conditioning down when it's not required. That would probably be the smartest thing to do.
Okay, thanks very much. Terrific. Okay, and let's hear from our next speaker, Anissa Rogers, the UMSU elected environmental spokesperson. Thank you, Anissa.
Thank you. Thank you so much for asking me to come and speak. Firstly, I would just like to re-acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land and to pay our respects to the Wurundjeri people, acknowledge that sovereignty was never stolen, and that I think this is a very important conversation to be having in this space in terms of sustainability, because not only are Indigenous and other marginalised people on the forefront of these catastrophes and affected disproportionately, but also there is incredible knowledge in these societies who have been dealing with the environment for hundreds of thousands of years. So start with that. I'm one of two new elected environmental representatives, and I'm also one of the co-coordinators of the Fossil Free Campaign, which has been mentioned already, has now been going for about 2.5 years, calling for the university to take its money out of fossil fuels. And reflecting on all of the stuff that Ellen was saying, our journeys are very similar. It's been incredibly rewarding many times for us to come across all of the incredible people in this university that care so much. But there have been huge blockages by those in the higher-ups, and it is a very difficult battle. And so thank you all for coming and hearing and being involved in this conversation that's so important. First, I just wanted to commend the university on putting this charter forward. It is a really positive step in the right direction. It contains a lot of good things, and as well as commend, there are incredible people in this university as individuals that work really hard in these different institutes. But although I am here to offer some criticisms from the student body and myself, firstly, talking from a student perspective, people my age, for my entire life, climate change has been known about, and still very little is being done. And that's a really difficult thing for students to come to grips with, because it seems like such a difficult battle. One example of this in recent, if people have seen in the news, is about ExxonMobil, where there was investigators that went through their emails and things like that and found out that they have known for 25 years, their chief scientists have known that this is a huge problem, but have consciously funded the climate denial that we see today. And so these are the sort of things that we're coming up against. And so this leads me to the divestment movement and fossil free. We have so many solutions, and the university is putting forward some of these, but while we still have these blockages by huge companies that have an economical interest in stopping the renewables, have share in the market, it's really difficult to enact change. And so that's where an act of divestment, which, as you've seen, has been a huge part of this charter. There's a lot of student, staff, alumni support behind this in responding to this charter, is that, yes, in terms of the financial sustainability, as Ross mentioned, it's financially good to get our money out of fossil fuels, but it's also a political motive that we need to take the social license away from this industry and give the political space for these changes to happen. And so that is really, that is why we think divestment should and really can be a part of this charter and implementation plan. I'd also like to say that that is not enough. We do recognise as students that divestment is an important, incredible step to creating this change. But as Arnaud and Hans, and if you have a chance to read their alternative charter, it makes for a good read, that we can't just switch to renewables and continue the status quo as it's going along. Solar panels, they take a lot of energy to produce. So while we're switching to renewables, if we're continuing to consume more energy, especially us in the developed world, then these solutions will just not come. So I think this is a really important step to start that conversation about the status quo and our current political and economic systems and how us in the first world are having that impact, and so we can leave the space for the developing world to live a good life. And so I think although this charter is a really good step forward, I really hope that it opens space for these conversations about the greater problems of our economic system and how we ever hope to, you know, climate change and all of the other environmental and social justice issues, how we ever hope to combat them without that discussion. So thank you.
Anissa, thank you very much for that. Now, we've got time now for more questions. Yes, take a question here.
Yeah, Anissa, thank you very much for that.
Just getting the microphone to you. Yep. There you go.
And identifying the global economy as the problem, because Naomi Klein wrote a book about that very recently. where she basically puts capitalism front and center in terms of being the primary source of climate change. But anyway, I'd like to make a pitch to Alan. I think it's great that there are two student representatives on the sustainability executive, but one party that is missing is the union, the NTU, and by the EBA, the union is supposed to have an input into sustainability matters. So I put it to Alan and the executive that we be included as well. Okay.
Alan, do you want to make a response on that?
Thanks, Hans. We've already responded to Hans, and I'm happy to have...
I think you've adequately responded.
OK, we've already responded to Hans. I'm happy to have a discussion about it and the role of sustainability executive compared to the role of the Sustainability Advocacy Forum, which is now in train. So there are, you know, there is a wider group that is available, so I'm happy to continue the dialogue.
Okay, all right. Another question? Yep, up the back there. Thank you.
Hello.
Yep. Yep.
I made a submission on the draft charter, but I must say that it's at the time of the year that I can't remember much of what is in the draft charter, and I haven't read the alternative. But just taking from the illustrations that Roger gave, it struck me that we're talking a bit about how the world has moved on in the time the charter is being under discussion, and it's not only about Paris, it's also much more local. And I'm wondering whether those who do have in mind what the charter says would feel that it intersects, at least in terms of language, with the spirit of the innovation statement coming from the federal government. That is, shouldn't it be a test of the sustainability charter that when you read it, you would see that an institution such as this university, which obviously plays an extremely prominent role in guiding the future of the knowledge economy, in all the kind of terminology that's being presented from the new Prime Minister, that this university sees sustainability in all its dimensions, climate change, resilience, social sustainability, economic sustainability, along with the moral and ethical issues, as a clear driver for innovation for the future of the knowledge economy of this country.
Interesting point. Roger, do you want to comment on that?
I'm not really sure what I could add to what Chris has already very eloquently said. It's I think that the game has changed somewhat. You know, we have a new Paris Agreement. It's a lot better than what we had at Copenhagen. So I think we're accelerating. The reasons for action, or the reasons for inaction, are gone. I mean, there's no holding back now. I think we should be really pushing down an accelerator, and we have to, because so many years of inaction have left us in a position where we have to reverse carbon emissions by 2020 and rapidly decline if we have any hope of meeting 2 degrees. So, yeah, I agree.
But in terms of seeing the, I think as you were saying, the very much the spirit and the language of Paris and what appears to be a different set of signals coming from the federal government. Would you like to see that reflected in the presentation and the rhetoric, if you like, of the sustainability charter of the university?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Right.
Comment on the innovation and the innovation statement. Universities play an incredible role in advocacy, and I think that can't be underplayed. It's not just about what we do here, but it's about the messages we're sending to the rest of the country and the rest of the world. You already know that. And so when something like the innovation statement comes out, I think that institutions who care about renewable energy innovation, for example, should actually lift their voices, because when you look at that innovation statement, we may be seeing some great language there and some great signals being sent, but on the other hand, we still have Turnbull saying he's going to cut the Clean Energy Finance Corporation and ARENA and some of those institutions that should underpin that innovation in renewables. So I'd love to see the university come out and say, that's not good enough. And I think everybody was just so relieved when he signalled a change in language. Everyone just, this collective sigh of relief that we didn't have Abbott blocking renewables anymore. But we all, I think, were a little bit too keen to jump on board and go, great, great, innovation, wonderful, wonderful, Turnbull, thank you so much for throwing us a little bone. Whereas actually we need to use this time to build our power, not just to sit back and accept what's given to us.
Mm-hmm. Ross, would you like to add a comment on that?
Yeah, I think
particularly, say, the public advocacy role, perhaps, that the university could lead on?
Yeah, I think it's a role for members of the university rather than the university itself. The university is not a political organisation or a party. It's an institution that provides a framework within which people can, as individuals and groups, participate in the public discussion. So I think that's the way it should be. I'm reminded of a conversation I was involved in, hosted by the Premier of China, just as Clinton was giving way to Bush, and the Premier of China has an annual meeting with a number of economists from around the world, and I was there, and he'd invited Larry Summers, who was just stepping down as Secretary of the US Treasury, to become President of Harvard. And Justin Lin Yifu, a Professor of Economics at Peking University, put a rather challenging question to the President-to-be of Harvard University. He said, Is it fair, Larry, to describe Harvard University as the most cost-effective part of the military establishment in the United States? And someone said, what do you mean? And Justin, he'd done all of his arithmetic, said, well, I've calculated that $27 trillion has been spent by the Pentagon in the Cold War, and it had no effect, but you sent three Harvard economists, Sachs and others, as advisors to the new Russian government, and Russia collapsed. Can't you take credit for being the most cost-effective part of the military establishment? And Summers responded, well, it's true that some of our people gave very bad advice to the government of Russia, but others, Dwight Perkins, gave exactly the opposite advice. Harvard University is happy to provide the vehicle through which clever people can participate in the public debate. So I think that's how it should be. I don't think the university is an advocacy institution. I think it can lead by example. It can make sure that in all of its programs, it simply honours the truth by making sure that sustainability is at the centre of everything it does. But it's up for us as individuals and as groups of individuals to be effective in the political sphere.
Alan?
Maxine, I just thought, just to add, I think Chris's point's a very good point, and we should look at the wording of the Charter in light of what's happened since the Charter was drafted, I think we will definitely do that. And just to pick up a little bit on a couple of the things that have been said here in terms of the innovation, I mean, the point's already been made about the university has committed to a new renewable energy project, which is actually unique in Australia, and that's for about 10% of our energy supply through a new renewable source. And to the Clean Energy Finance Corporation, we have actually just entered into arrangements with them to utilise that scheme in order to pick up on Roger's point, to actually have energy reduction programs rather than simply dealing with renewable energy, actually reducing what we do even further.
Okay. Yes, up there, and I'll come down the front. That's right, there, and then I'll come down here.
Health Sciences and broadcaster on 3RRR. I just think the Charter is a really good thing to start with. But the one thing for me that was really missing is the fact that I haven't done a count recently of what the university community is, but it's north of 50,000. And if you add in alumni and supporters and donors, you know, we're talking about several hundred thousand people. And I think there's a great opportunity to bring to bear that force for doing certain things. I know at my local primary school, you know, we've got 500 kids and we can paint a classroom in the weekend with help. The university is over 1,000 times that size. But the charter and the things I'm hearing don't really draw that together. All I hear is that there's an alternative version of the charter over here, and there's a student group over here, and another party over here. It would be great if we just all did something together for a change. And, you know, I understand that, you know, the alternative versions are great, although I should say a bit verbose. There's a lot of things that we could do better and really get some action going if we worked as a group. And if you take 50,000 people, not just the ones doing the research in the area, and that stuff is fantastic and it's all over the campus, but all those who are interested in actually doing something about this, I think you'd find it hard to find those who weren't.
Okay. Have you got a couple of activities in mind? Look, give us your top two.
Top two, I mean, I think it would be great if we did something like actually working on some of the poorer communities in the city that need assistance in this space, where some labour and some skills and some architectural input and so forth, we bring all that together, we can help some of these communities become more sustainable that can't afford to. Mm. For those of us who can whack solar PV panels on our roof, that's great. But most people can't afford to do that. Most people can't afford to make some of those easy changes because they're price prohibitive. Yeah. So we can help with that stuff. We do it in other areas, in health, in other areas the university does act in that regard. We could do it in this area too, but yeah. We have a massive community.
Mm, that sounds like a good social green enterprise. Yeah, great, okay. And yes, sir, you've had your hand up.
Just an interested member of the community. Thanks. And a little bit off the topic, perhaps, but with all this scientific skill available, they might be able to answer it. I noticed on this handout there's mention of ozone depletion. Now, I remember back in the 80s and 90s, the great concern of the ever-increasing hole in the ozone layer over the Antarctic. Something was done about it, I think. Different chemicals were used and so forth, and people were told to stop sunbaking themselves ever so. Is there still a concern, or is it interest just lost in the global warming movement? Does, do any of you know anything happening with the ozone layer over the Antarctic?
The ozone hole has stopped increasing in size. It's still actually at around about its maximum it's ever been. So the problem is still there. It certainly hasn't gone away. But the concentration of the chlorine chemicals in the atmosphere is declining. They're very long-lived species, so it'll take about 50 years to go back to pre-1980 levels. But at that point, the ozone hole will be back to its natural size. There actually is a small ozone depletion that occurs naturally each year. But it's an example of a great success story in that it was identified, the causes were shown, the policies were put in place to reduce the CFCs, and just the problem is that it takes a long time for it to fix naturally.
Ross, quick follow-up.
Just to emphasise the same point, it's a successful example of international cooperation where...
By the way, which country led on that? Or countries?
Well, the crucial decision was made in Canada, and Canada played a major role.
Right.
US played a major role.
Mm. Mm.
50 years, eh?
Thereabouts.
Okay, yeah,
good. Thank you. Okay, and there was a lady behind you, just behind you. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Sophia. I'm actually a student here, and I'd like to reflect the disappointment that this is being held at this date, because I can't see that many students in the audience, and I think that's a real shame. But just to follow on from Ellen's point about, you said something along the lines of very little of your learning happened in the classroom, and that you really did, we all exist as part of this very broad university community. And the other point as well, that although energy is a very important part of what we're talking about, sustainability has many manifestations in the physical and social space of the university. One of the things I think about the contemporary university, and this is global, is that a lot of activities have been divested to different businesses and corporations. And the charter doesn't necessarily reflect those in-between spaces of a lot of the material flows are actually, the responsibility for that is in private companies. And I'm just wondering what the university can do to leverage its position to expect more from its suppliers and the broader community and the businesses and co-curricular activities of students to make sure that it actually extends to the way the university exists fully.
Right. Who'd like to tackle that one?
Well, just to say that it's vitally important. It's the university doesn't exist in a bubble, and it has incredible influence on its community, its suppliers, and as the gentleman was saying, it's hundreds of thousands of people directly, but so many more indirectly. And that's part of what I meant about advocacy, is having parts of the university or individuals or groups within the university advocating for these kinds of changes beyond just the direct impact on the university. So the university could just say, let's put solar panels on and let's buy some credits and let's do a deal with a wind farm and we'll offset all of our energy use. But what about the energy use of the people that you buy your paper from or whatnot? You have so much more influence beyond that. And I think that's where the university can lead, rather than just saying, oh, well, we've done our bit, we've dealt with our little part of the world and then leave the rest of it. Actually, having academics going out there and pushing the boundaries on some of these innovations, having groups going out there and calling out bad decisions where they're made at a government or business level, all of those things, I think people and groups within the university have an incredible role to do that. And I actually think it's a testament to the strength of an institution that you can have dissent within it and have different groups saying different things and pushing the boundary. If that can't happen in a university, where can it happen?
Anissa, do you want to comment on that? Yeah.
Just putting it in the... I think it's a really, really important point. And one example of where this can happen back in the context of divestment is that Swinburne University has recently committed to divestment, the first Australian university to do that. And part of the difficulty of this is about the university administration talks about our funds are not managed, like, we don't directly manage our funds. We have an external fund manager, which is part of this, you know, pushing everything off into corporations. But what Swinburne has done is they have actively put out, a tender for a fossil-free portfolio, as well as other ethical considerations like landmines and things that are very, very important as well. And so I think with this push of, you know, the university community and the incredible people in it, we can see that change, but it's very difficult and very slow. And it would be really great if we could speed up that process.
Okay, okay. And so one more, we've got time for... And one more. We heard, is anyone further up there?
Any more women?
Yeah. OK, we'll take you again, sir. Thank you. Here we are.
Thanks. That was really interesting hearing some of those comments. I think just going back a little bit to the advocacy, I think there's a, you know, real opportunity we're seeing in that space opening up. And I don't know if you saw that opinion piece in The Age maybe last week from the Future Business Council. These are a group of people have gotten together and they sort of see the Australian Business Council as, you know, really old school and essentially representing mining. And so they've gone out with this Future Business Council model and they're trying to give a voice or create an opportunity for like-minded people within corporations to, you know, advocate for sustainability being injected into that national innovation conversation. And just the point the gentleman from Triple R, et cetera, was talking about in terms of coming together, we've, on this Melbourne Renewable Energy Project, we've seen, the power of collaboration. And collaboration, that word itself is, I think it's a real buzzword that slips into being a weasel word. You know, you go, oh, we're collaborating, all that kind of stuff. But when you actually see humans coming together and, you know, sort of not defining each other as you're a corporation person or you're a university boffin or a council, you know, laggard, but actually people getting in a room and trying to solve some of those really difficult procurement questions, which are really sometimes boring. Like, why is it a headache for the procurement guy to have a white bit of paper and a less white bit of paper? Well, it actually is a headache for him and, you know, that's a problem, and how do we actually work together to solve that? So I think just seeing that in this sort of 21st century era of collaboration, which I do feel is different from last century, we have a real opportunity, and particularly a university is a great vehicle for that.
Okay, good. Good. Thank you. Adrian, take this as the last one. Thanks.
Thank you, Maxine. And thank you, everyone. I'm Adrian Collette. I'm Vice Principal of Engagement here at the University. It's been a really fascinating conversation and a very helpful one to me. When I first became involved with the Sustainability Committee here at the University, I was really tempted to advocate making it part of the engagement strategy that my group was charged with creating for the university. And the university now has its first signed off engagement strategy. But of course, the obverse was true. The engagement strategy is a response to long-term sustainability for this institution and for the communities we serve. So the strategy itself doesn't answer to everything we have been talking about in the room, but for those of you who haven't read it, we released it a couple of weeks ago, and I think it responds to many. So we talk about engaged research, the kind of research we've been hearing about today that addresses itself to industry and community problems. And the thinking about engagement at the university is at a point of maturity that you will see more and more of that, and you will see more academics recruited and rewarded around that kind of activity. But also we point to six engagement programs that we're going to prioritise over the next five-year period out of the whole amazing bottom-up multitude of work that academics and professional staff do here. We've chosen six, we've chosen them through collaboration, and four of them are in what you'd call the social responsibility phase, serving the communities that are strategically important to us, both through creating educational pathways but also taking innovation into those communities. Some of them are pretty ambitious and could be quite complex. And others, and the other one is in the public policy space, where we harness the kind of thinking which is now coalescing around the university in this public policy precinct as a way we can exert influence without being an advocacy group for all the reasons Ross has explained. So if you get a chance, have a look at it. It's a short document of only 20 pages, but I think basically it is a response to the sustainability issues of the university, not all of them, but it goes to our relevance. And our relevance, as well as our excellence, is going to be the best guarantee we have about the long-term sustainability of this institution. Mm.
Thanks, Adrian. I'm glad you drew attention to that, so thanks for that. By the way, look, I'm probably not the only woman in the room wearing a summer dress today. Actually freezing. I know you're wearing shorts. Are you cold?
Yes.
One thing we could do, actually, is a bit of thermostat control. We don't need, you know, to be freezing in... Would that save a bit of energy, Roger?
Of course.
Yeah,
yes.
Thank you. Okay, right. Okay, good. Look, I just want to end by coming back to something that Ross said, and this does take us back to kind of the global picture, but highly relevant for whether it's University of Melbourne or any other institution. And I think this is... It's interesting to look at these tipping points in history. And Ross, do you feel we're at that point? I mean, you said something about, you know, the peer pressure now of nations. Do you feel, in fact, that what we could see is really quite a dramatic ramping up, simply because there will be a lot of competitive spirits between the big players, whether it's the US, China, others?
Yes, I do. One can't be so confident to say it's irreversible. If perchance Trump became president of the United States next year, then everything would go back into the melting pot. Fortunately, I think we're quite likely to have Hillary as president, and she will be as strong as Obama has been on these issues. But political accidents can happen. But the general momentum, is a very strong one. The lead up to Paris is very important. It's not just Paris itself. And Paris only happened because of what went 18 months before. You had that historic agreement between the President of the United States and the President of China, announced at the APEC meeting in Beijing at the end of 2014. Well, that was the first time China had committed to mitigation goals in an international context. It had been doing a lot itself, but that's the first time it committed internationally, and since then it strengthened those commitments. The Europeans have been in a strong space for quite a time, with a lot of leadership coming from Germany, Britain, France. So there wasn't dramatic change in Europe over this period. But what happened in the United States under Obama in his second term, and in and in China over these last few years is truly historic. The G7 meeting of heads of government in Germany in July last year recognised that all developed countries would have to have zero net emissions by the middle of this century. Well, that puts an anchor on things, and that was an unequivocal point of agreement amongst the seven biggest developed countries. Three European leaders and the President of the United States, Merkel, Hollande and Cameron and Obama, had sought to use the G20 meeting hosted by Australia in Brisbane last year as a launching pad for Paris. Now, our Prime Minister set out to sabotage that. Our then Prime Minister. The President of the United States, on the spur of the moment, decided to publicly rebuke him and gave that speech to 1,000 adoring students at Queensland University. And I think that was one of the points of undermining of Abbott. Yeah. Within his own party. So that's evidence of the momentum. And then there were two standouts amongst the developed countries, Abbott and Harper in Canada. Well, climate change was a major issue in the Canadian election just 6 weeks ago. Trudeau and the Liberal Party won a very big victory on a quite far-reaching climate program. So all of those show a growing international commitment, and that's come together at Paris. Now, the United States is one country that if it goes a different way, it can get away with it. But countries like ours can't. So long as you've got United States leaders continuing with what's already in place, I think it's going to be difficult for leaders of other countries to stand outside growing momentum. And we've got that anchor point, zero net emissions by the middle of the century. You can fudge things for a little while, but there's some indisputable arithmetic implication of that endpoint. Which will put pressure on everyone. And for that reason, I will be surprised if Malcolm Turnbull, if he's Prime Minister of Australia in 2017, doesn't lead a review that leads to a substantial strengthening of Australia's position in preparation for the 2018 meeting of the United Nations, which is geared to review the post-2020 commitment. So, yes, I think something really important has happened, not just at Paris, but in the lead up to Paris, culminating in the meeting last week.
Yeah. Thanks, Ross. Now, that's my set. Sorry, quick comment. Yep. Quick, we're close to time.
Question for all of the panel: what would be the top issue that you think the university could take on to show bold leadership in sustainability?
Quick one. You got one sentence, Anissa.
Wow, that's a very, very big question to put in one sentence. I mean, the first step is divestment, but the next step is to have a much broader conversation across all the curriculum about what true sustainability actually is.
Okay, Roger.
Oh, I'd say, coming back to the community deal that Shane was talking about, that we harness the university community to send a very strong message to Canberra and other governments that a price on carbon and strong energy policy is absolutely vital, as well as doing everything that we can ourselves on campus.
Fun.
You need to do everything. I know that's a wuss answer, but you have to do everything. You have to seed 1,000 gardens and some of them will bloom and you never know which ones are going to have the greatest impact. But the key word for me is responsibility, is not shirking our responsibility on any single element, looking across the entire influence of the university, not just our own emissions, but how we can influence our community.
Okay, Ross?
In addition to the things others have said, zero net emissions using all the Melbourne Energy Institute's clever ideas within 3 years.
Oh, there's a big one. You heard it here. How about that, Alan?
You're going to give us. Are you going to give us?
Are you going to give us a pre-Christmas commitment?
I think it's important that through the next little phase, early next year, that the plan does identify actions and targets, whether it's exactly what Ross has said, that do demonstrate the university is acting and leading. So I think that's something that we really need to focus on.
All right. Thank you. Look, I do have to wrap at this point, but look, thank you. You've been a very engaged audience. So could you show your appreciation for all of our guests today? Thank you. I mean, there is this, just to sum it, there is, as you've heard, there is this all-important question of the Charter. We encourage everyone to log on to the Sustainable Campus website where you can actually read the Charter. And, in fact, hence your alternate one is... That's going to be available as well, so you can look at that. And I also want to emphasise, and this has been in all the discussions that I've been involved in, nothing has been ruled in or ruled out. This is an open discussion, so it really is incumbent on all of us to be involved in this. Look, thank you so much. I tend to agree with Ross. I'm sort of more optimistic than I've ever been. And I'd also like to come back to what Adrian said. There is also there's incredible work that the university is doing, as we've heard from what Roger said. But the university is poised, I think, to play a very interesting role through Adrian's engagement strategy in sponsoring lively, thoughtful, challenging conversations around this. So 2016 looks to be pretty good. Thank you all for coming. Have a happy Christmas.